first I would like to thank the organizers for this kind invitation to speak about what is very close to my heart, which is the value of three and four dimensional ultrasound in fetal echo. So actually, the recent advantages in the three and four dimension of the fetal heart made evaluations of congenital heart anomalies much, I think, better. And I will say now for two values: one, to understand for yourself, and then to explain to your colleagues, to your students, and to your residents. So if one thinks this is, for example, cord around neck that I just depicted the day before yesterday, so you can see that there are two loops here of the cord around neck, and this is very easy. It's one shot in 10 seconds, you can see it. So it's this kind of thing that is not so easy to detect with the two dimension. You should have more imagination. And actually, what we have here is evaluation of real the volume, and because of the advantage of the color with the high definition color, we can see the volume as well as the direction of flow, which, as showed by previous speaker, is very important for what we do. This, for example, is a nice systole and diastole. And if you see, you can see the veins, for example, and other examples that I will show in a few seconds. So, for example, here one can see not only in two dimension the direction of flow, but the volume. And I want to show you here, for example, here you can see actually the systole, and you can see, and this is very important for my students as well as residents, to see the relation between the large vessels emerging from the heart. This is the right side, this is the left side. And you can see very easily that this is during systole, this is the left ventricle, and you can see that the aorta first is below the pulmonary artery, and then it goes to the right, and then in turn to the left. Sometimes it was there, for me, when I started, it was difficult to understand this. So, and you can see the pulmonary artery, and even now, this is the third trimester depiction, or at the end of the second semester, you can see that, as said before, that the pulmonary artery is wider than the aorta. And one can see during systole the inflow, which is the reddish inflow into the ventricles. So now I will give, this is the volume, and I will give few other example with the advantages of the 3D. So we start with one of the most difficult diagnoses that we have, is the coarctation of the aorta. So one can say that if you go either with color, and here you can see, if you can see here, and you go little by little, frame by frame, sometimes you can see the aorta as full, or sometimes you can imagine maybe this is a coarctation or maybe not. But if you have this kind of TY, and this is another option of having a three or four dimension, now it's quite easy understandable what we are talking about. And you can see, if you go here, the aorta looks not narrow. But if you can find it and you know the size of your slices, you know here this is a real narrowing here. And you can see here it's a real narrowing here. And here it's not so narrow. And then will help you to the true diagnosis of the post-ductal coarctation of the aorta. And you can see here the bifurcation of the aorta. And really, really, with this kind of color, you can see the thing much more precise than without the 3 and 4D. And you can add such a volume like this one, and then you can see that it's not as clear as before, but you can see the direction of flow. Direction of flow in this narrow aorta, this is the pulmonary artery, and this is the aorta. The direction of flow is opposite to what we expect at the three vessel and trachea view. This is the level that we see. And here you can see even the size of the aorta, the narrow size of the aorta, and of course with the comparison of the pulmonary artery and the direction of flow. So you can see it in if you take a longitudinal view with this volume, the HD volume, you can see this is a pulmonary artery, and here you can see the narrow aorta, which I think explained better the situation. Ruben is going to talk about the aortic arch anomaly. This is an old picture of 3 dimension, and as the last speaker said, this is right aortic arch with the U shape, and you see the trachea. But here you can see very beautiful the pseudo the pseudo ring of the aorta, in which in this hollow you can see both the trachea as well as the esophagus, and this make the diagnosis. This is quite an old depiction from like about 7 years ago, that you can see the right aortic arch. And in our days, one of the clues that you have right aortic arch, you can see the gap between the MPA and the ductus arteriosus here, and the aorta, which is tilt to the right. And this again makes the diagnosis of right aortic arch more, I think, evident. And one can should think whether there is the esophagus here, or the trachea, or both of them. One of the challenges that we have in the diagnosis is aortic ring. So what we have here is either to decide what do you have here. Either you have 2 aortic arches or only one. And you can see again, this is the trachea in the middle. And I think in my experience now, I use more and more the TUI in the diagnosing of fetal heart anomalies, because I believe that if you can see in few slices an anomaly, you can be more sure that what you diagnose is correct, because you can see here one arch, left arch here, and the right arch here. So you can see whether or not you have a double aortic arch, which make the ring. And with the use of the B flow, which is another advantage that we have in 3 and 4 dimension, you can see a complete ring of right arch and left arch in this case of a aortic ring. And if you go with it slowly here, I'm sorry about this movie, because it didn't work so good in these computers. You can see a complete aortic ring in this case, and even it's the same case as I showed you with the TUI. So the B flow is very, very sensitive for a low flow or low volume flow, which makes the diagnosis of aortic ring, I think, more evident. Tetralogy of Fallot is one of the most common diagnoses that we have. And here we can see a classical example. And you can see here the aorta, you can see here the VSD. And even with the 2D, you can see it. You can see the overriding aorta here and the pulmonary artery. This is what you start with. And I add to it the three dimension as well. And to understand the situation, you can see in one shot actually the whole what we have. If you look from the upper to the lower, you can see the aorta here, which override the septum. You can see that the flow coming from both ventricles, the left and the right ventricle, and if you are careful enough, you can see this is the four chamber view, and if you look very, if you see here the tiny stenosed pulmonary artery in the case of the tetralogy of Fallot. So if you go with this TUI, you can see the complete picture of the tetralogy of Fallot. And another example with the TUI. Again, you can see here the overriding aorta, and you can see here the tiny pulmonary artery, the stenosed pulmonary artery that come out from the right ventricle, and the VSD here in the middle. Now you can add to this what we have with the high definition and the rendering of the flow, and here again, one can see very beautiful the overriding dilated aorta. And if you go through this picture, one can see in comparison with the aorta, the narrower pulmonary artery, and this will make the full picture. And I think this picture is more understandable for people that first encountered with the quite common anomalies that we have in our day-to-day practice. And it is another example. Here's an example. One can see again, you see the dilated aorta going to the right, and this is the stenosed pulmonary artery. And one can see it again. You can see both the dilated aorta, the dilated overriding aorta, and the narrow pulmonary artery, which make our diagnosis, I think, much more evident and understandable for everyone. I think one of we showed it before. You can see it is detransposition of the great vessels, and I think with this 2D you can see again with the TUI, which I like so much. You can see that both parallel vessels, that the aorta coming supposedly from the right, and the pulmonary artery from the left. And I like it even, I can add to this the HD flow with the rendering, and you can see the parallel vessels. As you can see here, again, this is left and this is right. The aorta coming from the right and the pulmonary artery from the left. And how I can be sure, now you can add the TUI, and again you can see here the bifurcation of the anterior vessels, which usually the anterior artery is the pulmonary artery, and here you can see that the anterior vessel is the aorta, which convincing that we are talking about transposition, the detransposition of the great vessel. This case is an ongoing case with intersepton, which may need the Ruskin procedures that was discussed before. So both of it, and even for the intact septum, I think it's good to use the TUI in order to see the same picture, as the same take, is to see the whole size of the septum, see whether or not there is or there is not a VSD. Sometimes it's quite difficult to see it in a regular AVI. So here again, you can see the parallel vessels, and you can see this is the aorta of the right, the pulmonary artery. You can see the bifurcation, the pulmonary artery, main pulmonary artery, to both to pulmonary arteries. I like this picture from another case, and if you look carefully, you can see, I think, one of the hallmark of a transposition is whether or not the the aorta is anterior and the pulmonary artery is the posterior. And here you can see clearly that the aorta is above the pulmonary artery, which make your life easier in diagnosing transposition of the great arteries. Aberrant right subclavian artery is one of the most common, I would say, heart. I will not call it anomalies, but divergence from the normality, and it's very, very clearly. And one can see again with using the TY here, that you can see it's so easy to detect in several slices the aberrant vessels that's coming out of the aorta from a distance instead, and you can see it here, you can see it here, you can see it here, and not to be misled by the azygos artery, but you can see really that it's coming from the posterior part of the aortic arch, which is aberrant right subclavian artery. And here is a case that you can add to this. For the same case, you can add the volume, and you can see two vessels. The one, the reddish one, as showed before, and this is the pulmonary artery. This is the aortic arch. Here you can see the aberrant right subclavian artery coming from here, and this is the azygos vein coming from coming anteriorly to the superior vena cava. And then you can add another dimension for the diagnosis of aberrant right subclavian artery. There's another example of disadvantage. This is what was a quite difficult case in which you can see here, you can see the aberrant vessel coming from the aorta in one case of interrupted inferior vena cava with azygos continuation. And what I want to show here, that this is really an advantage in complex cases. As you can see here, the aorta, this is one bifurcation, this is another bifurcation of the aorta, and you can see it here, the aberrant vessel. Why it is important? Because I think in our days, the sensitivity and the specificity, as can you say, of this modality, make it real advantage to diagnose difficult cases. I believe that the precordial veins, the evaluation of precordial veins, the 3D and 4D of the precordial veins really gained a lot from the 3D and the 4D. And this is a paper from now 8 years ago, and there is another one from 2015, of the group of Reuven and myself, that show that we can really go through the precordial veins and diagnose them, and we divided it to several levels. We called it the afferent and the efferent, and so if you take the caudal portion of the portal system, which I don't have time to show you, and this is the portal sinus, and here you can see the anterior and posterior portal vein, and you can see the main portal vein, and really if you go a little bit scaffold for this, you can see the trident of the hepatic system. And now I think that the ductus venosus should be diagnosed not in a transverse section, but on longitudinal section, and really you can show this. And this is the new advantage of we have now with the new HDPD, and you can see how sensitive is this modality, and this can help a lot in a complicated cases of precordial veins anomaly. Look what we can see. We can see if I will talk the internal mammary arteries. You can see here very clearly the pulmonary vein, the pulmonary arteries. Again, one more pulmonary vein. You can see the aorta, of course, the inferior vena cava. You can see one of the left hepatic vein. Not to speak that you can see here in one shot. You can see here all the umbilical vein, and then the portal sinus, and then again these two vessels are part of the hepatic system. So this make your life easier, much more than we had before, like 10 years ago, and this rather look like more two dimension depiction of the veins. Here again, this is the interrupted inferior vena cava. One is most classical. And this is the classical way that you diagnose interrupted inferior vena cava. You do the longitudinal scan of the fetal heart, and you see two longitudinal vessels, one in blue, one in red, which is impossible to understand. Why sometimes the vessel is blue and the other time is red. This is not one vessel is two vessel. One is the azygos vein and another one is the aorta. And as showed before, in the normal, you shouldn't have more than one vessel behind the heart. If you have two of them, the one and close to the aorta, it should be the azygos vein. And you can, in order to diagnose, this is a normal one. We can see the inferior vena cava with the B flow, and one you can see with the B flow, this is an azygos vein, and there is no inferior vena cava here, only the ductus venosus, and you can see the azygos vein just drain into the superior vena cava, and this is a normal case. You can see the inferior vena cava, which we never saw here. And this is another case, and with a little bit more complicated. We don't see here the inferior vena cava, and we just see the aorta. You can see ductus venosus, and say it was more complicated case, but again, it was interrupted inferior vena cava. This is the B flow with azygos continuation. And the first clue, this is another case that's interrupted inferior vena cava. You can see here sometime, it's very, very important to see if you do such TUI, you can see a very large azygos vein. And when you see a very large azygos vein, you should think about maybe this is the case of interrupted inferior vena cava and azygos continuation. And now, with use of the HDPD, you can see the both vessels that I showed before. With the most sensitive, you can see here the aorta, and you can see a large, very large vessel here, the azygos veins that come to drain to the superior vena cava. And this is with another view of the same case. You can see the aorta here, and you can see the azygos vein continue to the superior vena cava. And again, another look of the same case, you can see how large and big is the azygos vein, which replaces the inferior vena cava. Most of the hepatic shunt, the intrahepatic and extrahepatic, you can use both other, the HDPD, or the B flow. I think the B flow has still a place because it's very, very sensitive to low. This is another case of you can see the hepatic, the portal vein. This is the hepatic vein, the trident, the famous trident picture of the hepatic vein. Here's the umbilical vein, and then the core is caudal to it. And this is the aorta. You can see the whole system, and this is the case of Portohepatic shunt. You can see this is the trident, and you can see an extra vessel here, an extra vessel which is a shunt between the portal and the hepatic system. And I think the three dimension, the four dimension, make it much clearer to see. And you can see here even not only one shunt and two shunt coming from the portal system into the hepatic system, which make your life easier. And maybe because I think I am going to pass my time, this is the case that that Laurent Fermoz, I don't see here the movie, that is a conjoined twins at about 20 week of gestation, that you can see a common heart, because this patient the family was an ultra-Orthodox family. They wanted to know whether the heart really connected, the ventricles, the heart is really connected. You cannot separate two sides of the heart. And what helped me a lot, it's quite complicated here, and you could see both here, the inflow, and you could see this reddish. And I don't have time, and it's quite complicated to understand it, but this helped me a lot to understand that you can see here the inflow, and the red one here, I will do it again. And the red one here is the inflow of one ventricle just crossed to the other heart and just connected between the two hearts. And for me, it was easy to see both. And this is one of the pulmonary arteries coming out of one of the ventricles. But the connection between the two hearts through this make the diagnosis of really what we suspected, really. But I think it was another proof that really the both sides are connected. And this you can see here again with a depiction of this is to inflow, and you can see the reddish here, it's coming from the right ventricle of one fetus to the left ventricle of the other, which made the diagnosis of these two hearts are really connected. They were aligned like a mirror image between them, but for me, it was, we suspected it is not that we made the diagnosis based on this, but this makes for me another proof of that these two hearts are connected. The last thing I want to speak is it was again that we use all the time the TAPSE, one of the kind of what I believe is the function of the heart from the right side. We believe that the right side is the dominant ventricle during fetal life, and you can see the annular movement here. We can depict it with like an M mode, but what's nice about it that one can do it with the three dimension. You can see it with two dimension, but the three dimension, and we depict all of this, but the three dimension give us the opportunity to do all these tests. Not, this is a 3D actually, when the heart is not aligned with the apical four chamber view, you still use the stick air mode and just to see the excretion of the annulus of the tricuspid valve, which I believe is one of the most important tools to diagnose a malfunction of the heart. So in summary, I believe that for the anatomy and for the function, the three and four dimension of the fetal heart makes not only our life easier, but in some aspect even more accurate and more reassuring, and most, I think, from more importantly, the 3D and 4D is more understandable for newcomers to the field, and to explain to the family as well as the colleagues the situation of malformed heart. Thank you very much.